Colum Breen's grandfather started a carriage-making business here in 1883. The Breens entered the business at a relatively late stage. Horse-drawn vehicles were still very popular, but this was the eve of the motor car. The trade began to decline in the 1930s as the motor car made its impact in Ireland. It was reprieved during World War II, but by 1947, petrol rationing had ended and traps, gigs and other horse-drawn vehicles were abandoned. The Breen brothers only kept their skills by turning to other work. The various craftsmen restored antique furniture, painted churches and houses, produced wrought iron work, and did shop fitting. Foreign markets led to a revival in the 70s, and the future now looks promising. Carriage making is not a single craft. It is in reality a process which brings together a variety of skilled craftsmen. There are five crafts involved: the coachsmith, the bodybuilder, the wheelwright, the coach painter, and the upholsterer. In making the forecarriage for a four-wheeled vehicle, the coachsmith, Pat Sludds, makes an iron crosspiece which is bedded in wood to form part of a Victoria being built. The pattern to be followed is drawn on the floor of the forge. Though mail coaches, goods drays, large and small carriages, and coaches for the gentry were usually all fitted with four carriages, the vast majority of horse-drawn vehicles in Ireland were two-wheeled. The tub trap was the general purpose vehicle for every man in the past. Most large towns had their own tub trap makers, who specialized in steam bending the bodies. Elm, American birch or walnut, was steam bent while green and then left for 5 or 6 years to season. Elm, because of its attractive grain for varnishing and finishing, was most favored. In recent years, thousands of old traps have been sold for export and most of the old trap makers have disappeared. The Breens also do a lot of restoration work. This is a rally car. All craftsmen have a love for the tools of their trade. This love is seen in the care they take of them. Getting a good edge on the large turning chisels prior to shaping a spindle is an essential task. Kevin Breen, a brother of Colum's, is an expert wood turner and makes the delicate spindles for the gigs. In the past, the source of power for the lathe would almost certainly have been a springy pole or a foot pedal. A variety of chisels is used to mold the different patterns. A handful of shavings helps to smooth the almost finished spindle. The ends of the spindle are trimmed at the bench before being twisted into position in the body of the spindle gig. To get a good fit is a very skillful job. The reason for the recent success of the Breens is the revival of interest in the horse. In America, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, people are collecting, displaying, and using for leisure horse-drawn carriages of every description. In the United States alone, it is estimated that there are 9 million carriage horses, and this number far exceeds the number there in the second half of the 19th century, at the time the West was being colonized. The smooth running of any vehicle depends to a large degree on the perfect symmetry of the wheel. Because of this, it must be constructed with great accuracy. Any irregularity or unevenness not only makes for discomfort, but also excessive wear and an inevitable breakdown. Pat Roach, the wheelwright, is fitting spokes into the stock, or hub as it would now be called. The stock was usually made of elm with spokes of oak. Setting the spokes in the stock is a delicate job, for the more they are driven home, the more difficult it becomes to correct faults. A breast stick is used to check the alignment and size at regular intervals. All timber used in the manufacture of a wheel must be well seasoned, a process that can take 10 years or more. For this reason, wheelwrights often use parts of old wheels again and are always on the lookout for suitable pieces. The felloes which surround the wheel are generally made of ash, which is very flexible and has great strength. After the first felloe has been loosely fitted, a tool called a spoke lever or a spoke dog is required. This draws the spokes together for the final fitting, and when removed, the tension on the spokes keeps the felloes in place. The task of making a wheel falls into five distinct stages. First, the stock making and mortising. Next, the spokes and felloes have to be made and assembled. Then comes the tiring, or putting on the metal bands. And finally, boxing or fitting the cast iron box into the centre of the stock to take the wear of the revolving wheel. Back in the forge, the wheel approaches the next stage. A traveller, which works on the same principle as the surveyor's wheel, measures out the length of metal required to band the wheel. The wheel is placed on a tiring platform and locked into position to keep it steady. In most parts of the country, the tyre would have been heated by lighting a turf fire all around its circumference. But predictably in County Wexford, a power-driven Pierce's fire fan is used in this much speedier process. Wheel dogs are used to turn the hot metal band and later to lift it onto the wheel. In position, the band must be quickly cooled before it burns the wood. And as it contracts on cooling, it grips the wheel even more tightly. Only if the wheel becomes excessively dry will this band ever become loose. The need for well-seasoned timber is obvious. When the bands did loosen, people often solved the problem by covering them with wet sacks for a period of time. The spoked wheel can be truly said to thrive in damp conditions, not like the motor car. Perhaps it was the finish more than anything else which made old horse-drawn vehicles so distinctive. Almost all vehicles had a pattern of decoration which included lines both fine and broad, which were as accurate as a modern transfer. These lines were always applied with the full length of the squirrel hair brush. No task calls for such a sure hand or steady eye. Colum Breen and his carriage works have been supplied with coach enamel by the same firm, Parsons of Dublin, since 1883. Before this stage is reached, much preparation has taken place. The wheel is sanded and primed to give later coats a key to the original timber. Undercoated, filled and sanded again, from 10 to 12 coats of paint are applied to give the desired finish. All paint is brushed on to give a depth of paint and a mirror finish. Sprays are just not satisfactory. The early motor cars, by the way, also had this type of finish in pre-assembly line days. Another spectacular feature of many old coaches was the leather work. Leather was widely used for springs, panels, upholstery, and, as in this case, wings or mudguards for a Victoria carriage. Patent leather is used, and after the pricking wheel has marked out the position of the stitches, the holes are made with an awl. The leather is sewn using two needles. This two-handed action was once a common sight in the workshops of harness makers, boot makers, and other leather workers. The thread is waxed to make it water repellent. Artie Sludds has the confident, rapid movements of the true craftsman. Though much of the Breen's work consists of repairs and restoration, the works also manufacture new vehicles. The forecarriage seen earlier under construction was for a Victoria. As the various parts come together, The completed vehicle takes shape. It would be impossible to show all the stages of construction. The magnificent upholstery in this vehicle is reminiscent of the grandeur of another age. The work on these carriages and coaches compares well with the coaches in the National Museum, the Dublin Lord Mayor's coach, and Henry Grattan's or Daniel O'Connell's great mobile platform, covered with green baize and trimmed with golden tassels and binding. The skills required to produce these magnificent coaches survive. It is a pity that the Irish coach, built by Hutton of Dublin and still used by the English monarch, is the only Irish ceremonial coach now seen frequently in public. It has been estimated that there are, or were, 200 types of horse-drawn vehicles, not counting hybrids. As time progressed, many of these, like this landau, had more technical innovations added. The landau was basically a convertible, an open carriage with two hoods, which could be raised to meet in the centre to make it completely enclosed. This coach or drag was once the property of the Gore Booth family. It was designed to carry large numbers both inside and out. 21 people in all could be accommodated. Coaches of this kind became popular in Ireland in the 18th century, and it is unlikely that this drag is less than 150 years old. It was the railway that first made this type of coach obsolete. This drag, which was completely built in Breen's works, is for sale. Colum Breen's nephews, Billy and John, and nieces, Brigine and Elizabeth, cannot fail to grow up with a love and appreciation of these skills. They excite the imagination of youth and age alike. The drag would normally have been pulled by four horses, two pairs harnessed on each side of a splinter bar. A single animal or pair was often added to assist the coach up a steep hill, or if the going was heavy. The strap windows remind us how much the early railways borrowed from the coach builders. The braking shoe is similar to that designed for 18th century mail coaches and was also used on farm carts in the Leixlip area of Dublin within living memory.
It runs up on the drag here and it drags along the road. It acts as a brake. The coach itself is a ton weight, only four horses pulling it.
There has been a revival of interest in horse-drawn vehicles in Ireland in recent years. The Driving Club of Ireland now holds regular rallies for such owners. Powers Court, near Enniscorthy, County Wicklow, was the venue for this rally. As with motor car rallies, the contestants are timed over a prepared course. But compared to the screaming whine of engines, the soothing sounds of the animals' hooves are much more pleasant. It must be said that this is an expensive sport, but it is also a sport which can be enjoyed by young and old alike, and also by the disabled. Great private collections of these original vehicles have been built up, and it is a matter of public concern to see that these collections are retained in the country. In these horse-drawn vehicles, the hands of many craftsmen have produced objects of grace and beauty which every one of us can appreciate. Ha ha ha.